New Year, amen. God is a good God, and He's worthy of praise. He's worthy of glory. Amen. Mr. Han come to be prayed for right at the beginning of the service, and I think there's more people should do that. If you feel like you need prayer, then you should go and get prayer. Because you know where the answer is? It's in Jesus. That's where the answer is. The answer for your soul, the answer for your body, the answer for your finances, the answer for your marriage, the answer for your children, amen, the answer for your mental health. It's all found in Jesus. Amen. The Prince of Peace is the only one that is able to come and bring true peace into the heart and into the life of a man or of a woman. And so I'm so thankful today that I am born again, that I'm saved, and that I know Jesus Christ as my Lord and as my Savior. And as I look ahead into the future and I see the things that are coming, there are some things that are not so pleasant, not so good, that are coming to our world and into the nations of our planet. But I'm so thankful today that I am under the covering of the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. If the trumpet were to sound today, I know where I'm going. Or if I were to lay my head on the pillow tonight and not wake up when the morning came, I know where I'm going. Amen. Because of who Jesus Christ is and what He has done for me. And so I rejoice in that truth on the first Sunday of 2020. I rejoice in what the Lord has done, what He's doing, and what He's going to do. Amen. In my life and in your life. And so we give you a warm welcome to church today. If you're visiting with us, feel at home, worship the Lord along with us. And if you haven't been out to church for a while, we're glad to see you back. Amen. Let this be your church. Come anytime. We love you here at Grace Pentecostal Church. Amen. And we're glad that you're here with us today. Now, a few announcements before we begin our worship. Special welcome to our keyboard player. I almost forgot. Good to see Billy. Billy's all grown up since he last went to Labrador. He can grow a beard and everything. It's amazing what can happen in a few months. Amen. We're glad that he's here with us. Amen. I haven't asked him to sing, but he's going to sing a special tonight if the snow holds off. If the snow holds off, Dylan's going to sing tonight, so we'll see what happens. Amen. That being said, it is calling for a snowstorm this evening, and so we'll see. We'll make a decision about supper water, see what's happening. So don't start calling 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock. It's your church. It's your church. Let's wait. Let's see what happens. And around supper hour, myself and the church board will make a decision. And if it's not bad weather or blustery, there will be church, all right, at 7 o'clock. And you're all welcome to come and join us. There's a few other announcements in the bulletin as well. Communion, of course, today, but it's also Mission Sunday, the first Sunday of the month. And so I am pleased and excited and very happy to report to you in the year 2019, we met our goal of $17,000 and we surpassed it. And at the end of the year of last Sunday, we raised $18,896. Wow. Amen. I commented to somebody as they came in, it was on the slides coming up. I said, you know what? We're in a good church. We're in a good church. The Lord is moving. Things are happening. Amen. We're in a good church. And so God is blessing us and doing good things. That's so wonderful that we met that goal and surpassed it. Amen. The Lord bless you. Also, thank you to those that donated in memory of a loved one to the WM Tree of Memories. The total donations that came in were $830, and so that's a lot of money as well. All the names are on the tree out in the foyer. I was going to read them all out, but there's just too many to read. We'd be here for 10 minutes or so reading them. But you can look at it on your way out. They've been there all the month of December. And so thank you to those that donated. 100% of those donations will go to missions, Change Matters, the WM Mission Program. And so not one bit of it will be kept behind. It will all go to missions. Amen. So the Lord bless you to those that have given. Also on January the 19th, the rest of the announcements are there for you to look at yourself. But on January the 19th at 7 p.m. in our evening service, that's a Sunday evening, we're going to be having a water baptismal service. We do have two candidates that want to be baptized in water. And so if you have not yet been baptized in water and you're a born-again believer in Jesus Christ, I would be glad to do that for you. The scripture tells us that we should do it. And whether you're Pentecostal or United or Anglican or Salvation Army or Catholic, if you're a born-again believer in Jesus Christ and you've not been baptized in water through full immersion, then I would encourage you to come along in that service. And I would be glad to do that for you. It's for the young and the old and everybody in between. As long as you're born again, it's for every single believer. So that will be January the 19th in our evening service. Amen. Stand with me. Greet each other. Welcome each other to church. This morning we're going to sing the chorus, "We're Free to Worship." We're all free to worship. Amen. We're going to sing that together and then remain standing for prayer. And then Pastor Lenore is going to come and lead us in our worship time. Hallelujah.
Oh, I'm set free.
Yes.
Downcast, Lord,
those that are going through valley experiences, those that are struggling, Lord, those here in the sanctuary, others that are watching online, Lord, that are going through dark valleys, Lord, I pray that you would reveal yourself unto them, Lord, as the one that is able to strengthen and encourage, the one that is able to answer and deliver.
Amen.
You would set captives free, Lord, is our prayer. That you would heal the many that are sick, that we would hear good reports, Lord, of how you've healed and delivered, Lord, from cancer and from all manner of sickness and disease, from mental health issues, from addictions, Lord, that you would deliver in the mighty name of Jesus. We do pray, Lord, for this coming year. We thank you for what has been done in the past year, Lord, but we pray, Lord, for the weeks and months ahead of your return, that there will be a mighty outpouring of your Holy Spirit. Lord, that there would be souls saved, that revival would break out, Lord, in Bonavista, Lord. Not only in Grace Pentecostal Church, Lord, but in every church, oh God, that would proclaim the name of Jesus, Lord. I pray that souls would be saved, lives would be changed, that revival would break out, the power of the Holy Spirit would be poured out upon Bonavista, Lord. Oh God, in the favor of the worldwide, Lord, the glory of God, Lord, to the glory of God.
Hallelujah.
Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus, we ask these things. Amen. And amen. You may be seated. We're going to invite Pastor Lenore to come lead us in worship. Amen. Receive the Lord's tithe and offering as well.
It's wonderful to be in the house of the Lord this morning. New year upon us. And all the things that the Lord has in store for us. For our individual lives and for our family, for our church family, all those from Bonavista, right on down to Chamonix, and everybody that's here worshiping with us this morning in the building and online, we're so thankful to the Lord. We're going to sing that chorus together. Glory, glory, hallelujah, since I laid my burdens down. And if you haven't done that, this is a wonderful Sunday to do that in the new year. To lay your burdens down and to pick up God's plan for your life.
Amen.
And that plan is a good plan, a plan to prosper you. Lord, we just pray in this moment that you would open up our hearts to receive all that you have for us.
Yes.
That we would come before you this morning with open hearts of worship, honest hearts of worship, Lord. And that we would give you all the praise and all the glory that you deserve.
Glory, glory.
Yeah.
give God the glory while you remain standing.
Give God.
You can remain seated for now. Divine appointment.
Yes, Lord.
You see, there in their living room, in their bedroom this morning. They haven't even had the courage to get out of the bed. They just reached over to grab the computer and the iPad. They're sitting to their table. They're watching with their partner this morning. They've already looked at one another. And their hearts before you. This morning you see them. They're longing for freedom. Even as they sit there now, they don't know how they'll be able to undo all the things that have happened and what they've done. But they need freedom. And we pray that this would be the morning. This is their divine appointment, December the 5th, 2020. Loose the powers that hold them this morning in their indecision, oh God, we pray. May there be a holy visitation to them in this moment. And your convicting Holy Spirit would rest in their hearts and over their homes and in their minds this day. God has visited someone this morning.
reach in and tell somebody what you've done there in your home this morning so that you can continue to grow. We're going to stand all over this house. This is rejoicing. There's so much that we can be weighed down about. There's so much going on in our lives and our families. Even as we enter into a new year, and there's a prospect of things improving, and God has spoken a word, and the only thing that combats that in our lives and our hearts this morning is to bring Him the worship and the praise and the honor that He deserves. We're going to sing that song, I Love the Name of Jesus. I know we almost wore it out in 2019. But we're going to keep singing it. Blessed be the name of the Lord. There's power. There's healing. There's victory. There's love this morning. There's everything you need in the name of Jesus this morning. Let's sing it like we believe it as we stand together and worship the Lord.
I love the name of Jesus.
Yes.
Jesus has come to save.
Jesus has come to save.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. The Lord is speaking to us through the power of His Holy Spirit this morning. It is communion morning. We're going to give time for that in a little bit for the preaching of the word. But the scripture that comes to mind is found in John chapter 10, verse 10, that you would all, most of us would know this morning. It speaks of a thief that comes with not good intentions. But the scripture says the thief comes only to steal and to kill and to destroy. Come to steal your peace. He's come to steal your hope. He's come to steal the joy. He's come to steal your purpose. He's come to steal your life. These are the words of Jesus speaking about the enemy of your soul. And then he continues and Jesus makes this statement. He says, but I have come. I have come that they may have life. And that they may have more abundant life. See, there's an enemy that is going around and he's prowling around like a lion seeking to devour and to steal from people, to ultimately to destroy and to keep you out of faith and to keep you out of a relationship with God. But Jesus Christ, your Lord and your Savior, the one that we celebrated this Christmas season, loves you, he cares about you, he is passionate about you, and he desires to give you not only life, but life to the full abundance of life. So I can't point you to anywhere else but to Jesus Christ. He is the answer for your soul. He is the answer for your life. He is the answer for your happiness. He is the answer for your peace. He is the answer for your family. He is the only answer I can give you today. There was a man called Jesus that was born of a virgin. There was a man called Jesus that was born of a virgin because he was a son of God that went to a cross. The scripture tells me that he didn't have authority to take his life because he's the son of God. He could have called legions of angels, but he gave up his life as ransom to redeem you, to save you, to set you free. And he was placed in that tomb. And you want to know something? That the tomb couldn't hold Jesus. Death couldn't keep his grip on Jesus. That's why he's the answer this morning. That's why he's the answer this morning. That's why he's different than all the other prophets. That's why he's different than all the other religious leaders. That's why he's different than this pastor or this church or that religion. Jesus Christ rose from the dead. Because he's the Son of God. He's able to give you life. He's able to give you abundance of life. He's the answer for your soul. In the beginning of 2020, you need to give your life to Jesus. Put your faith and your trust in Jesus. Start this year out the right way. Serving God. Living for God. Yes, there's one seeking to devour. Yes, there's one that is trying to steal, kill, destroy you and your home and your family and your faith and your health and all of these things. But there's also one who is greater. There's also one who is greater. There's also one that is able to give you life. Hallelujah. Let's sing the chorus together. I'm going to invite Pastor Lord to come back. We're going to sing one more chorus before we hand it over to Pastor Cory for the word. But the altar is open today if you need Jesus. And if you're watching online today or in the days ahead and you click on this video, then we would encourage you to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and as your Savior. You can kneel down by your bed or by your chest of field or by your chair or at the table or driving in your vehicle or wherever you find yourself. Simply say, Jesus, come into my life. Forgive me of my sins. And he will come in and he will forgive you and he will cleanse you. And from that moment on, you serve the Lord the best that you can. You get in church and you learn and you grow and you mature and serve God the best that you can. And you Amen. Let us stand together one more time, congregation, as Pastor Lenore comes to lead us before we have the word. The altar is open if you need Jesus this morning. The altar is open.
Set your heart through the worship of this service, through through the plead of the Holy Spirit to surrender your all. And he's about to speak through his word. Lord, we pray that there would be a divine anointing. Your word is a living word. It was God breathed. And every word of it is true, and it's been established in the heavens and on earth. And we pray that as it's spoken this morning, it will go forth in power. And hearts of men and women and young people and boys and girls this morning and in the day's hands would receive the word of the Lord. They would receive the word of the Lord, a word of hope, a word of truth, the peace and the joy that they seek for and long for this morning. May your blessing be upon your servant. And you would have these next moments to speak by the power of the Holy Spirit. Transform and change. May this be a divine moment in the name of Jesus. We give it all to you. Amen.
Spirit, we ask, oh God, that your will be accomplished this morning completely, Lord. You have well for the service, oh God, not just for us to come to just attend church, although that's a great part of your word, what you want us to do, but as that you want to do something in our lives, in the lives of people, and most importantly, God, you want to save souls. We know it's your will, Lord. So I pray to be souls saved. I pray to be deliverance, God. I pray to be victory, oh God. And I pray we would realize what we've walked into, oh God. That our faith doesn't just stop at the cross, Lord, but it moves from the cross to the resurrection and to the fact that you brought us into new life and is a place that's prepared for us, God. We have victory in our lives, Lord, and we proclaim it because your word tells us that we have victory in our lives, Lord. So I pray you'd have your way in this place. We would look at what you've done for us, Jesus, when you went to that cross, and we would see the victory that you've given to us in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. So what I want to look into, I want to look into this feast. And the first feast that the Israelites was asked to prepare was the feast of Passover. They were asked to prepare it on the first month of their year, their calendar year, which is known as the month of Nisan, N-I-S-A-N. And it was on the 14th day that they would have to do it, but the preparation actually was done on the 10th day, as you will see. I want to talk to you about this a little bit. The first thing I want to mention is the first point, which is the preparation of the Passover feast. I want to look at history first and look a little into what it was for them, and then we apply it to the work of the Lord, as you will see in the last part of this message. But the first thing I want to mention is the preparation of the Passover feast. If you return to Exodus chapter 12, starting in verse 1, you would see the idea of preparation of a Passover feast being presented to the Israelites while they are in bondage in Egypt. So this is important. They're still in bondage. God is presenting this Passover feast to them, and he's showing them the preparation. And I'm going to read to you starting in verse 1 of chapter 12 of Exodus. It says, "The Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, This month shall be unto you the beginning of months." So that was the beginning of the calendar year. "It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, In the 10th day of this month they shall take to them every man a lamb according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. And if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next unto his house take it according to the number of the souls. Every man according to his eating shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish of male the first year. Ye shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats. And ye shall keep them until the 14th day of the same month," 14th of Nisan. "And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. And he shall take of the blood and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper door posts of the house wherein they shall eat it. And they shall eat the flesh in that outer post with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Eat not of it raw nor sodden at all with water, but roast with fire, his head and put his legs, and with the pertinence thereof. And ye shall have nothing of it remained until the morning." So they were to eat all of it. "And that which remained of it until the morning, ye shall burn with fire. And thus shall ye eat it, with your loins girded, your shoes of your feet on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and ye shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. For I shall pass through the land of Egypt this night, and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord, and the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where ye are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. And this day shall be unto you for a memorial, and ye shall keep it a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. Ye shall keep it a feast by an ordinance forever." Basically, the Lord there was telling the people of Israel that they were to prepare this feast, this Passover, while they were in the land of Egypt. This is not the same scripture, of course, as in the book of Leviticus. As a little later, the Lord lays out that they are to keep these feasts as a memorial, and goes on and on. But right here, he tells them about the memorial too, and he's giving them this direction while they're in bodies. And the first thing you see him give them is this preparation idea. I'm going to show you how to prepare. There's a preparation that's needed, and this preparation actually involves something. You might not have recognized what it involved, but it actually involved the raising up of a lamb. You guys were raising lambs and goats for a period of time, and you didn't even recognize that at some point I was going to call on you in the midst of this raising of these lambs and goats to use these for to bring you out of bondage. There's a preparation that was being done. And what I want you to do is I want you to take all the lambs that are would without spot and without blemish, and you're going to take them, the ones that have no defect in them, and you're going to kill them, have them killed, and there's going to be a shedding of blood, and you're going to take that blood and you're going to apply it to the doorpost and the mantle across the top of the door, and this is where you're going to get the victory. So there was a preparation that was happening, even though the Israelites might not have recognized it. No bones were to be broken in the killing of this lamb. They were just to kill it and use the blood, and they were to eat the lamb. Now, this is very important because there's always a preparation that goes on, and you will see this a little later. But I do want to move on in this point and go to the next one, because where there was a preparation, there was also a purpose. Do you believe there was a purpose in the Passover church? See, Israel had found himself in bondage. As a matter of fact, Scripture tells us in the book of Exodus that they were in Egypt for 430 years. That's what it tells us precisely. 430 years. Now, how long they were in bondage as slaves for, I can't really tell you. Many believe that it's around 400 years, but it might not have been that long, roughly. We know they were in there for a long period of time, and a part of that time, or a good period of that time, there arose a Pharaoh who knew not God and brought them in as slaves. So they found themselves in a place where they were not free. They were not free to worship. They were not free to go where they wanted. They were not free to do what they wanted. They were in absolute slavery. They were in absolute bondage. And this is where they found themselves. But God established this Passover for a purpose. And one of the first purposes that God established this Passover for the Israelites was for to establish freedom in their lives. Freedom in their lives. Now the first portion of freedom you see is in the physical sense. How many of you know that they were physically bound? And this is evident because they weren't free to go anywhere, do anything that they really wanted to do. They couldn't leave the land. They were slaves to them. They were bearing things for Pharaoh. They were under the taskmaster's whips. And it was a cruel, cruel scourging that they were under. And the burden was laid upon their shoulders heavily. So they weren't free. And they needed to be liberated physically. So this lamb was going to be given because this was going to be the thing that was going to cause them to come out and be free. Upon the death of the firstborn, when the death angel passed over, the blood of the lamb upon their doorpost was the thing that was going to set them free. Amen? So there was a physical deliverance. And what we often don't notice, and what we often don't know, is there was need also for Israel to be freed spiritually. Yes, there was. Did you know that? There was a need for them to be freed spiritually. You can almost imagine what it would be like to go for a long period of time without being able to worship God. Just think about that for a second. No time to worship, just being slaves and being beaten down on and being in bondage for years upon years, even generations passing. After a while, you begin to lose something. After a while, you begin to lose out. After a while, you find yourself in a place where you don't know where to go or what to do. And this is the situation they found themselves in. So what was happening was they weren't allowed to worship God in the way they should worship God. And we see this in the reality that when God spoke to Moses, he said to them, "Tell Pharaoh to let my people go that they may come out and worship me." You see, they were in bondage not only physically but also spiritually. And you add on to this, you've got to understand that the Egyptians worshiped a lot of false gods. As a matter of fact, they worshiped numerous gods. Many gods they worshiped. Now, God was about to set them free, not only physically by the Passover feast, by the Passover lamb, but he was also about to set them free spiritually, because he says this to them. And if you read, I just read the portion of Scripture, it said this in Exodus 12, "I will pass through the land of Egypt this night. I will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord." You can only imagine the impact of not being able to worship, but being surrounded by false gods and watching these other people worship these false gods all the time. So what we see is this reality. And we don't often notice that when God was sending the plagues, he was actually not just coming against the Egyptians, but he was actually coming against the false gods. Did you know that? He was. You see, the gods of the Egyptians actually represented various things. They believed in the river god. They believed in the god of even the frogs and the bulls. And I'll show this to you. I'll just give you some examples. It was believed that when God turned the Nile into blood, remember that first plague, we're right after the staff was turned into a snake, of course. When he turned the Nile into blood, he was attacking the worship of the god Nun, K-H-N-U-N, which was known as the god of the river. After that followed a plague of frogs, and it was said that this was an attack on the god of Ek, and the Egyptians worshipped the god of Ek. It was said to be the wife of the river god, and frog-headed, again, literally. After this, you see what happens is there's a swarm of flies, and this was said to be attacking the false god known as Beelzebub, the prince of the air. And you look it up, Beelzebub also means the lord of the flies. Livestock were punished as a sign against the false god Apis. This was the sacred boy. You wonder why they had the idea of making a golden calf in the wilderness? Well, this was worship in Egypt, the sacred boy. And the plague of balls were right in the face of the false god Imhotep, which was their god of miracles or healing. This is the gods that Egypt worshipped. And locusts opposed Nephali, because Nephali was known as the grain god. So they would worship them for grain gods. So God sent locusts to destroy the grain. The darkness was against Ray, R-E, the sun god, because they worshiped the sun and the sun god. So when darkness came, it came against it all. You've got to see what's happening here. God said, I'm going to execute judgment upon all the false gods of Egypt. And basically what I'm going to show you is there are no gods at all. There's only one God. I am God. And everything you're praying to has no control. I'm the only sovereign God, and I'm the only one on the throne. And I'm going to prove this to you by coming against all the things that you pray to, thinking that they're gods. You see what's happening? So this is something that's going on. What's happening is God is liberating the Israelites from Egyptian bondage. Not just literally. It wasn't only the purpose of the Passover to liberate them and give them freedom literally. It was also in a spiritual sense. They were attached to these things, and they needed to understand that there was only one true God, and it was the God that they worshiped and the God that they served. Now, we can move on just a little bit here. What's interesting about this is the month that it's in. If you were to look at the date, and I said it was the first month of the year, the month of Nisan, that's the Hebrew calendar. Now, the month of Nisan was another month, a special month for the Egyptians as well. As a matter of fact, they also worshipped the god by the name of Amon, A-M-O-N. And this was the god that was said to be the Ed of all their gods. So they actually had an hierarchy in their system as well. So Amon was said to be the god above all their gods. He was the Ed of all the gods. And just when they worshipped them in the month of Nisan. Literally. So this month that the Lord is about to give the Passover is in the month of Nisan. Now, what's believed is that the Egyptians believed that Amon's pinnacle of power, when Amon was the strongest, the head of their gods, was on the 14th of Nisan. Oh my, there's something happening here, isn't there? God is about to liberate them. This is the day that they come out. On the 10th of Nisan, they're told to prepare it. And on the 14th is the day of the Passover. This is where deliverance is going to be, but it's not just going to be on any regular day. It's going to be on the day where they believe the head of their gods is at the pinnacle of their power. And God's going to show them there's no power in any of these things, because I am the Lord, and I say what goes, and there's no such thing as any other false gods, because there's only one God. You see what's happening? This is the deliverance that's happening for them. So we understand that the Passover had a purpose, and one of the purposes was for freedom, to establish freedom in their lives, both physically and spiritually. There was another purpose for the Passover, just briefly, was of course to bring remembrance. This is what God said to them, this day it shall be unto you for a memorial. You shall remember. And God continues to remind the Israelites down through Scripture over and over of, I will brought them out from Egypt. You'll see this constantly in Scripture, wouldn't you? He keeps reminding them, and there's a reason. Because he wants them to remember where they were. He wants them to remember what it was like. He wants them to remember how hard it was, so that they would never forget and be unthankful of the fact that where God brought them from and where they're to now and the deliverance that's about to come upon them. So this idea of being a memorial is to set them free from ever wanting to go back to Egypt and understanding what it was truly like there and where he brought them from and where he's about to bring them from. Do you see it? This is what's happening. Another reason for the purpose, or another purpose, is so that they would participate. You've seen it in the scripture that was just read. They were to eat all of it. All of it was to be consumed. And then they would take the blood as a participation that's going on it. And they were to apply the blood to the doorposts and the top and mantle of the door, as was already said. But in doing so, they were to trust in the blood, weren't they? Is a participation. I see grace and faith involved here. You don't deserve this, Israelites. But I'm going to do it anyway. And what you need to do is when you put the blood on the doorpost, you've got to trust that it's going to save you from the death angel that's passing over. You've got to trust. And in order to trust in the blood, you've got to trust in my word. So I'm the one who said to you that the dead angel's going to pass over. And I'm the one who told you that if you do this and you put the blood on the doorpost, then the dead angel will not strike your home and the firstborn will not die in your home. So what you're seeing happening here is there's a trust put in God's word and there's a trust put in the application of the blood. So they're participating. This is another part of the purpose of the Passover. Now to move on from there into the final part for the side of the Old Testament and the Israelites, you have the practice of the Passover, and you see this in the sense of what was said in Exodus chapter 4, 12, verse 14. He shall keep it a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. He shall keep it a feast by an ordinance forever. God's saying to them, you're going to practice this, and this is going to be a part of your life as an ordinance forever. This is something that's going to be built upon, and something that's going to last, and you're going to worship around this. There's going to be a focus around this, because it's very important that you do this. This Passover feast. Now, I said all of that for a reason, because there's an application that comes to where we are. We need to understand, of course, how it's applicable to us today through what Jesus has done. How many believe that? Amen?
Amen.
There's a Passover pointed to something. And this is what we need to look at. We need to look at the feast fulfilled, the fulfillment of this feast. What was this truly talking about? And how are the things that was already mentioned applicable to us as a church and to people who are unsaved, those that are watching online, how is this applicable to us? You know, it's amazing, and it never ceases to amaze me, that God can take His Word and He can put it in such a way that He can give something to someone thousands of years before even Jesus came to the scene, and then He can take His Son and use it in such a way that He can bring it to fulfillment and totality in His Son. Isn't that amazing? Only God could do that. You see, the feast was fulfilled. This was only a shadow of something. God was only giving this to the Israelites, yes, to set them free, yes, to deliver them, yes, to give them something to remember, yes, so they could declare His mighty works, yes, so they could participate in it. But it all pointed forward to something for them in that day. And of course, it points back to something for us, but it still applies to our lives today as well. Amen? Fulfillment of the Passover feast. You see, you're going to see the same thing here. I talked about the preparation of the Passover feast. Well, Scripture tells me that Jesus was the lamb that was slain before the foundations of the world. Did you know there's a preparation, church? Amen? There's a preparation. We looked at the raising of the lambs. It's amazing that they had to raise a lamb. But Jesus was raised up as the Passover lamb. Now, I'm not going to get too deep into what I wanted to mention because it was preached about on a sermon not too long ago on close to Christmas about the shepherds and big go-eater and all these things. But I do want to mention that right from the beginning, Jesus was a symbol of the Passover lamb right when He was in that manger. Because Scripture tells us that the angels appeared unto the shepherds, and when they appeared unto the shepherds, He said, you shall find a babe lying in a manger, and this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find him swaddled in swaddling clothes. He's laying in a manger, and he's in swaddling clothes. And if you were to study into the history, and look into the Talmud, and the Mishnah, and all these historical writings that the Pharisees and the Jewish people had to follow in their day, it was oral traditions and rules that they had to follow, you would understand that they were not allowed to raise livestock in the land of Israel, especially between Jerusalem and Bethlehem. And if they did raise it, there was only one permit. It had to be raised for temple worship. So any lambs that was raised within that land had to be brought for temple worship and sacrifice. And what they would do was they would take these lambs that were raised, and if they were without spot and blemish, they would wrap them in what was known as swaddling clothes. And swaddling clothes was all priest garments. So all of a sudden, shepherds are in the field and they're in the land. But they're not just raising any sheep, they're raising the sheep for the purpose of sacrifice in the temple. Because according to the Mishnah and the Talmud, you weren't allowed to have them unless you were doing it. So this is what they were doing. And they would have been witness to the reality that the swaddling clothes was wrapped around these lambs. This old priest garment was wrapped around these lambs as a sign to be brought into the temple. And then they see Jesus, and what is He wrapped in? He's wrapped in swaddling clothes. Old priest garments. That's what it was. So I believe you can study into it. You can take the time to study into it. Right from the beginning, we understand that there was a preparation happening. That Jesus came into this world, and this was the Lamb of God. Amen? Now this was further verified when He went to be baptized by John, because you know what happened when He comes to John. John sees Jesus off in the distance by the River Jordan, and what does He cry out? He says, behold, the Lamb of God, who will take away the sins of the world, which taken away the sins of the world. And we understand that we see the Lamb of God being raised up in this world for a purpose. There's a preparation that's happening. And you see it over and over and over. Because a lot of times we don't realize what's happening. Mary anoints Jesus' head and anoints Jesus' feet the day before he enters into Jerusalem for a triumphal entry. Did you know what he did with the lambs in that day? Some days before, they would take anointing oil and put up on the head of the lamb and put over the body of the lamb so that the lamb would be preserved for the day of Passover. And they would do it in the week that followed, right before the Passover celebration. And then Mary decides to take the oil and put up on Jesus on that Saturday, the day before Sunday. And then all of a sudden we understand that on that Sunday, what we call Palm Sunday, people would begin to bring their lambs into Jerusalem and pick their lambs up, because that was the 10th of Nisan, and it was a preparation happening. And what day does Jesus decide to come into Jerusalem? It's on Palm Sunday, the 10th of Nisan. The Lamb of God comes riding on a donkey into Jerusalem as they're preparing for the Passover, and everybody's picking up their lambs to bring for a sacrifice. I don't know, church, but I found it absolutely astounding to look at all of this. Amen?
Amen.
You see, there's something that's happening. There's a preparation that's happening. There's things that's going on. When Jesus meets with them in his Passover meal, he tells them that he's about to be the one that's going to be given. This is my body which is broken for you. This is my blood which is shed for you. And there's a setting up in this Passover meal, a Passover in remembrance of what they did in the days of Israel. But there's more behind it than that, because the people needed deliverance in a very big way, not only physically, but they needed deliverance spiritually. And the only way they were going to get it is if the Lamb of God laid down his life and presented his blood before the Father so that it can be applied to our hearts so that we can have freedom. Amen? That's what it was. So this is what happens. You see it, the Sanhedrin even does something. You take Jesus and they bind them, and they would bind the lambs to bring him to Egypt. Then on a Sunday, bring him before Pilate. Why did he go before Pilate? Pilate looks at him. And when he looks at him, he says, I find no fault in this man. You know what he was doing? He was examining Jesus. That's what he was doing. And the high priest and the priest would have to examine the lambs to make sure they were without spot and blemish. And even Pilate, a Roman soldier, a Roman general, looked and said, I find no fault in him. He's without blemish and he's without spot. Having this man killed and crucified, he done nothing wrong. There's a thing that's happening here that kind of symbolizes right what's going on hand in hand, and you see it come to pass in all of these things as it ties in with the Passover feast. It's amazing what happens, even in a sense. Did you know that Jesus had to be offered up by the high priest? He couldn't be offered up. A lot of people talk about the Roman soldiers killed Jesus. Where really, like Pastor Shannon already said, no one took his life from him. He laid it down on his own accord, but they were used in the sense of his crucifixion. But it wasn't truly the Roman soldiers who offered Jesus up. You know, it was who offered Jesus up, other than he laid down his life by himself. It was the high priest. He was brought before the Sanhedrin, and the Sanhedrin brought him before Pilate. And when he was brought before the Pilate, they started to try crucifying him. And what happened was it was led by Caiaphas, who was the high priest. And in order for a lamb sacrifice to be accepted, the high priest was the one who had to offer it up. So you see this thing happening that goes hand in hand with the Passover meal. That Jesus is our Passover feast, and he's the fulfillment of it. Who don't believe that Jesus was their Messiah. That's what I'd like to do with this message. The scripture reveals it so really, doesn't it? It shows the truth of it so greatly in this day and in this age. And we know what happens. Jesus goes up at the same hour that they're offering up the Passover lamb on the day of Passover in the temple, and they're sacrificing it to the hour. Jesus is on the cross and he's crying out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And then he goes on to say, isn't it is finished? And he gives up the ghost, the scripture says. And he dies. The lamb that was slain for our sins. He gave his life for it. There's so much more that we could look at in this, but I'm going to move on because there's a purpose for it. Amen? Do you believe there's a purpose, church?
Amen.
There's a purpose in the Passover lamb going to the cross. We already looked at it in the sense of Israel. I would say to you that the first purpose of the Passover, not the foremost, but just one of the purposes of the lamb going to the cross, just foremost in one sense, but not an area of this first point, is to establish freedom. Do you believe that? Establish freedom. First, freedom in the physical sense, because Scripture tells me that by His stripes we are healed. So I see that we're sick and we come under this condemnation of sickness, and I don't understand all things. I don't know why some people don't be healed. I can't explain none of that to you. All I know is we've got to trust God at His Word, take Him at His Word, pray for healing, believe for it, and keep trusting God in the midst of it all. That's all we've got to do, amen? That's what He asks us to do. But we know that Scripture teaches us that the Lamb was slain and the stripes that was put upon His back when He was nailed to that cross, it was for our physical healing. I still believe in physical healing, church. And I believe there's a healing virtue that can flow through its place and touch you right where you are and make you better and make you whole from the most awful sickness. Yes, I do. Doesn't matter how old you are, doesn't matter how young you are, doesn't matter what disease you have, God is able to heal that disease because Jesus went to the cross and was to establish freedom in your body physically. Yes, it is. He died for you so that you could be healed. He did. Well, I believe the gospel. Amen. I believe in healing. I believe in miracle power. I believe our God can perform miracles. Do you believe that? I believe He can heal your body. Yes, I do. You can heal your body. You can heal your body where you are. You can come to this altar and be prayed over. You can sit in your seat. The Spirit of God can come upon you right where you are. And you can get healing right where you are this morning, right now, under the power of God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Praise His holy name. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It wasn't only to establish freedom in the physical sense, though. It was also to establish freedom in the spiritual sense. The purpose of the Passover feast. You know we're in spiritual bondage. We understand this. Just like Israel was under a taskmaster. It was mentioned here this morning. It was being prophesied and the words was being spoken. There's so many that's in spiritual bondage. They're captive by the enemy and He's onslaughting your souls and He's a hard taskmaster and He puts them on your shoulders so much and it's such an hard battle, such a hard fight and it's such a hard struggle in people's lives because we're separated from God because of our sin. We're a slave to sin, Scripture tells us. We're in bondage to it. It tells us before we know the Lord. So just like Israel had to be set free physically, they also had to be set free spiritually. You remember how God said this? He said, I will pasture the land of Egypt. It's not Passover. Think about it. This night, and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast. And then He said this, and against all the gods of Egypt, I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. I thought it was astounding that they had all these false gods and Amon's pinnacle of power was on the day of Passover, the 14th, or so they believed. And this was the time that they worshiped the deity. As we see somewhat the anger and the animosity and the hatred of the enemy during the time of Jesus' death, don't we? Not that Jesus' death was the Son of God, because we know it was. He came to die to save the world. But God uses all these evil things to bring about His plan. All things work together for good. Even the works of the enemy, God's able to take and work it for your good. Did you know that?
Amen.
It's hard sometimes, but He's able to do it. Because this was a lot of evil behind these things and the motives of people's acts. But God knew it and set it up and used it for His glory so that we could be saved. You see this in Judas, don't you? I see the enemy rage. I see Amon and bending all his power, or so he thought. I see the enemy raging, but he's sat behind that table, the Passover meal, and Jesus has to look and says, one of you, the one who dips your hand in this bread with me, is going to betray me. You remember that? And then He says, go and do what you must do. And the Bible tells me something. It didn't just say that Judas went on and done and betrayed him. The Bible says that Satan entered into him, and he went and betrayed him. Isn't that the devil's work? The Pentecostal God of His power. I see the hatred of the Pharisees mocking and scourging and beating upon Jesus. I see the hatred of the Roman soldiers mocking His kingship and beating upon Him. I see the reality that He taught He was at the pinnacle of His power. This false God, this top thinking of a deity, thinking He was like God, Satan. He's at the pinnacle of His power. But all of a sudden, something different is about to happen. Because when Satan taught He was at the pinnacle of His power, there was a Passover lamb that was slain that was going to defeat and crush the works of the devil and every false god that ever existed. Amen. This is what was happening, church. Scripture tells us about it. That He came to crush the works of the enemy. Is this not what it says?
Right.
The reason the Son of God appeared, 1 John, was to destroy the works of the devil. Amen? All that sin nature, all that sinfulness, all those things that hold you in captivity, all those things that hold you in bondage, all those things that are pushing you down, all those things that come against you, I've come to destroy the works of the devil. That's the prophecy that was given to Adam and Eve, wasn't it? He shall bruise your heel. There's going to be enmity between the woman's seed and Satan. Satan's going to bruise your heel. There's going to be a bit of backlash. There's going to be an onslaught. But you will crush, Sister Lydia, his heel. You will destroy his heel. When Jesus came, just like the Israelites was in bondage, and they were not only set free literally in a physical sense, they were set free spiritually from the bondage was around them. All the false gods, all the power of the false gods. When Jesus came, we were set free not only physically, but spiritually from all the sin and all the power of all those false gods and all the things that are trying to control us. That's what he's come to do. He's come to crush it. As a matter of fact, Scripture mentions when he goes to the cross, some of the things that he did. This is one portion of what it mentions in Colossians chapter 2. You, being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, that he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us. We couldn't keep the law. We broke the law. We were sinners and guilty before God. We were separated before God. He kept the law perfectly. The judgment of God come upon him. He paid the price for our ransom so that we could be set free. We couldn't get out of it. We couldn't work our way out of it. Jesus went there for us. And then it says this. Took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross, and having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. He conquered it all, church. He went into hell and he took the keys of hell, death, and the grave. And he said, I got the victory. And he come up with the victory and his resurrection power. And then he grants it out to each and every one who's going to follow him. Come out of bondage. Oh, Lord God. Oh, Lord, I preach this morning. There's freedom from bondage. Hallelujah. But you're going to crush his head. And yes, there might be workings of the devil and the workings of Satan, but the power of my God and the power of Jesus is so much greater and so much better as he delivers us by his power. You want to know the purpose of the Passover? The purpose he comes is to set people free. Amen? To save people and deliver people. And to take you out of that spiritual bondage that you're in. And if you don't know Jesus, you're in spiritual bondage. He can deliver you. Yes, amen. You know, you know Jesus, you can still be in bondage because you might recognize what he's really done for you. You might be in bondage for various reasons. But let me say to you, he can set you free and he can deliver you. Yourself. You can be free because even the Son sets free. He's free indeed. Hallelujah. Now we're going to small and wicked. Communion is sorry. The Lord out of his wife. Amen. Let him do the same.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm glad I'm free. And I am free. Because I know what it's like to be bound by sin and troubles and everything else. And I know what it's like to be in this bondage where life seems like it's not worthless and pointless and you just want to make a way with yourself. But when Jesus got a hold of my life, yes, I might not be perfect, but I know I'm a child of God. And when he got a hold of my life, he set me free. Glory to God. I couldn't even talk to people for years. I sit in the car with my friends, didn't even know what to say. I said it before. Now I don't want to shut up. One, to set me free, Lord God. That's why I didn't know what word to say. I didn't know how to talk to people. I didn't. But God set me free. That's what he did. And he set you free. Why did he set you free? He set you free to worship him. He set you free to praise him. He set you free to testify about it. He set you free not to be bound. Not to stay under Pharaoh or taskmaster's whip. Not to stay under the devil. He set you free so that you can be free, Lord God. Oh, Lord, hallelujah. Shout it. Is that Pentecostal pastor? Shout it. I don't know if it knows how to preach any other way. Glory to God. Everybody, everybody, I suppose. Glory to God.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. The purpose was to set you free. The purpose was for remembrance. This day shall be unto you for a memorial. And when Jesus comes to the Passover meal, he says, this do in remembrance of me. You're going to remember, because if you don't remember, you can easily think that it's better back where you were. But you've got to remember where you were, where I brought you from, what it was like when you're there, and what it's truly like when you're following me and worshiping me and in a relationship with me, and how much better it is to be serving me. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. We get this whole idea of people think, oh, church is just rules and regulations. Oh, religion is just rules and regulations. Church is freedom.
Yes.
If you're following the Lord and is truly following Jesus, there's freedom. I'm not bound by sin. I'm not bound by these things anymore. I'm actually free from the sin nature by giving my life to Jesus, which gives me freedom then to follow Him freely with love in my heart towards the Lord, as a desire to follow His will and His word. You see the difference? The enemy blinds people. You're going to do, you're going to be bound. No, if you're not in relationship with Jesus, you're already bound. Facts. You're serving of one master or the other, Scripture tells us. So remember where I brought you from, lest you forget and you run away from me once again, you fall away from me. And the next part, of course, of this, who be closing this, is to participate. I love this. You're going to eat all of the land, you're going to consume it all. You're going to consume every bit, you're going to leave nothing, just consume it all. All of Jesus. I surrender. I everything of Jesus. I can't trust in any of my own works. I can't trust in the slightest of what I'm doing. Not even in the least bit. I got to consume all of what He's done for me. You're going to consume all. And when you consume all, you're going to come out with ace. You're going to come running out. Glory to God. It says no bones were to be broken. None of those bones were broken. All was to be consumed. There's going to be a shedding of blood. It's absolutely astounding. You know, sometimes the devil will get your mind off the fact that I wish I had that song there. Now there's a song that was sung about, is the blood still there? You know what I mean? The devil will get your mind off the fact of who you truly are, and if you're truly saved, and if the blood's there, especially when storm comes. Especially when the rains is heavy and the wind is heavy and the enemy's attacking and the death angel is about to pass over and you don't know what's going to happen. You get your mind off of it and try to make you believe that the blood is still not there. But the blood is there based upon faith in His word. Because He told us that if we call on the name of Jesus, we shall be saved. And He covered us by His blood. I thank God that there's still a blood covering. I thank God that there's a covering that passes through death unto life. And even if we die physically in this body, we don't have to worry about the death angel, because there's eternal life waiting for us. I thank God that there's a blood covering, and it sits around us. It actually pushes back the works of the enemy. Do you believe that, church? The enemy attacks, yes, you can feel those attacks. You can actually feel it sometimes. You can actually feel the spiritual warfare that's going on. But if you want to put your trust in the blood of Jesus Christ and trust in His sacrifice, you understand that He cannot penetrate and pass by that covering and that edge that sit upon you. The God, our Lord, our Savior, has all power. Glory to God. By faith we participate. We believe God's word and we know the blood is applied. And I thank God for His presence at the same time that He does give us healing and is a witness to us that we are the children of God according to Scripture. But it's what faith, it's a walk of faith, amen? And we know it. And finally we come to the last point when I ask the musicians to return. The practice of the Passover feast, amen? You shall keep it a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. You shall keep it a feast by ordinance forever and ever. Part of what we're doing here this morning is a practice of the ordinance. We're looking at what Jesus did for us. Our Passover lamb that gave His life and shed His blood so that we could be saved, so that we could be delivered, so that we could come out. We're not just going to have this physical healing in it. There's deliverance from the enemy. There's power over the works of the enemy. This is taught before us for these purposes. And it's going to be an ordinance forever, because what He gave to Israel as a Passover meal and shifted into what Jesus did. Now we remember Jesus. So are Jewish people meant to remember Jesus and His sacrifice and come from what was under the Old Testament into the New. And that's going to go on into all of eternity, isn't it? You know, John saw a vision in Revelation. Do you know what he saw? He saw this book that couldn't be opened by nobody. And made it sore for nobody could open the book. And then stepped forward this lamb that was slain. Scripture tells us. And the lamb opens the book, the seals. He's able to open the book. He's the only one that's worthy. It says the elders bow down before him and worship him. The elders representing the church in that portion of scripture. This idea that the church is going to reign and live with God as kings and priests, but we're going to reign to worship him. And the scripture says that they cry out, worthy, worthy, worthy the lamb. Worthy the lamb that was slain. He was worthy. Only he could open the seals. Only he could open the book. This is an idea of an ordinance for every church. It actually refers, let me read some of it to you before we close the sermon. I'd be out, I heard the voice of many angels running about the throne, the priests and the elders. The number of them was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands. Saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb. Here it is again, the Passover. That was slain to receive power and riches. And wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. And every creature which is in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and such as are in the sea, and all that are in them, heard I saying, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb forever and ever. The four beasts said amen, and the 24 elders fell down and worshiped him that liveth forever and ever. When we participate in worship, when we praise the Lord, we're only doing what's happening in heaven. And something that we'll do for all of eternity. Because we're going to practice it. It's going to be a celebration. It's going to be something that continues on for all of eternity. We're going to worship and we're going to praise the Lord, church. That's what we're going to do. It's an ordinance forever. He is the one who redeemed us by his blood. Glory to God. I believe you deserve, no one deserves, but I believe you deserve this morning. Our Lord deserves a hand of praise. Amen. For a great sacrifice, I'm going to ask you to stand, and Pastor Shannon's going to come. He's going to lead us in this communion service. But can we take a moment to worship the Lord? He's our Passover lamb. And all victory is in him. For those online, you want to give your heart to the Lord, cause already went for it. You just need to cry out to him in sincerity in your heart and know that he will answer and save your soul. May God be with each and every one of you. In Jesus' name, amen. May God bless you. Let's worship the Lord. Let's stand in his place. Pastor Shannon, Jesus. Oh, Lord.
person in the Catalina Assembly to join me, Clayton and Murray, and two board members from Bonavista Assembly, Walt and Randy. You four gentlemen, if you would join me down the front, and we're going to prepare to have communion together this morning before we dismiss our service. If some of you have to slip out, you're free to do that, but I would encourage you to stay, amen, and take time as we remember the sacrifice of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's sing this over a few more times as the board members join.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus.
It's a wonderful opportunity to remember the symbolization of the Passover night. The one who gave us life so that we could have life. Amen. It's Christ. So that we could be here and we could celebrate, worship one another, the body of Christ, members of the body of Christ. Amen. Paul was writing to the Corinthians, and this is what he said. He said, "For I received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." Let's partake.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Day, Lord, in remembrance of the price that was paid. A lamb without blemish, a lamb without defect, a sacrifice for the sins of the world. We give you praise, Lord Jesus. We give you praise. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me, for whenever you eat of the bread and drink of the cup, proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's partake of the cup together in remembrance of his shed blood.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Take a few moments to give thanks for his shed blood this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. In this atmosphere, in this presence of the Lord, presence of the Holy Spirit, if there's anybody that would like to be anointed, amen, prayed for, by his stripes that we are healed. And so we will be glad to anoint you and pray with you today. There is healing. There is a healing available to the children of God. Amen. Let's sing a chorus together. Worship the Lord. If you'd like to be anointed, we'd be glad to do that for you. The Lord bless you.
And when he sees